The broadcast operations of controversial TV network SMNI suspended for alleged franchise violations. RJ Cruz reports.
The National Telecommunications Commission issues a show cause order and suspends for 30 days the operations of Suarasug Media Corporation, otherwise known as Sunshine Media Network International or SMNI. Acting on House Resolution 189, which urged the regulator to suspend the outfit for alleged violations of its congressional franchise. The regulator explained it respects the findings of the House that the grantee violated its franchise on three occasions, citing its authority over franchises.
Labas po namin ng show cause order ay ito po ay yung initiatory process para po sa ganitong type of administrative hearing. May nakalagay naman po dun sa show cause order namin na failure to file their written answer within the given period shall be considered na po na waiver of their right to explain. In which case, kung ano po yung evidence na meron po sa kanila, yun po ang pagbabasihan ng NTC to decide on this issue. We do not feel any pressure po from the politically regarding po dito sa hakbang or sa issue po na ito.
On December 11, the House adopted Resolution 189 citing three violations, specifically SMNI's failure in its responsibility to the public when it was found to have aired threats and disinformation in claiming that Speaker Martin Romualdez has a 1.8 billion peso travel budget, which was later found to be false. The same resolution found that the company's stocks were transferred without congressional consent and that it also failed to disperse 30% of its stocks as required by the franchise. Suarasug has 15 days from receipt to explain why it should not be held accountable. Lawmaker Gastam Munting, chairman of the House Committee on Legislative Franchises, welcomes the NTC's decision. He also thanks the agency for heeding the call of Congress for greater accountability among those granted franchises. His committee is investigating the network for alleged franchise violations. But Senator Amy Marcos slammed the NTC and asked why the NTC suspended the media company. She also flagged the NTC for issuing the suspension before an explanation could even be given. Marcos believes there was nothing prudent in what the NTC did, claiming there was no due process. She urged the NTC to be judicious, saying such action may have a chilling effect on press freedom. The NTC finds another ally in House Deputy Minority Leader Franz Castro, who believes the regulator is correcting SMNI's wrongdoings. Castro believes this is not about press freedom, as she alleges SMNI itself is a threat to press freedom because of its disinformation and advocacy of violence and hate speech. Castro hopes this isn't the last of SMNI's accountability. The National Union of Journalists in the Philippines stands by its previous statement against red tagging, but it is wary that the heavy hand of Congress could send the same message as it did in the previous administration. Behave or you could be next. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
Now for more on the suspended order slapped on SMNI, we're now joined by Professor Danilo Arao. He's an Associate Professor of Journalism in UP Diliman. First of all, Merry Christmas to you, Prof, and thanks for joining us today. Welcome to the program.
Yes, happy holidays, and thank you for inviting me again.
All right, so SMNI suspended. They're given 15 days to answer. There's going to be an administrative hearing come January 4th, I think, if I'm not mistaken. Your thoughts on the suspension ordered by the NTC?
Yeah, of course, there is reason to worry. As mentioned by NUJP, the chilling effect is definitely there. However, we have to, you know, even at the risk of sounding like a broken record, this is not a press freedom issue. This is not a press freedom issue. And SMNI deserves to be publicly chastised, and they deserve what's coming for them. Let me just clarify, Carmina, that much as personally I welcome the suspension of SMNI, it should not be government agencies like the NTC or even Congress, for that matter, who recommended the suspension to the NTC to do this. There is a way for media self-regulation to, you know, work its natural way so that those erring media networks can be put in their proper places.
All right. Let me just backtrack a bit here and get your thoughts on this burning issue, because, of course, they're saying it's politically motivated. But we know how it's been. We know how this one goes. But I want to know what you think. Do you think it's politically motivated?
Definitely, it's politically motivated because SMNI used to be in the good graces of the powers that be, but now they're not. And apparently, it's because they have chosen to take the side of one particular faction at the expense of the other. And it is in that context, Carmina, that we can see the banter between Celis and Badoy as regards the reported 1.8 billion travel funds, which turned out to be inaccurate. They were talking about how a certain person or how the House Speaker himself could be able to spend that much money, umuuwi pa ba siya? You know, things like that would have certain subtexts. But even if, Carmina, let me clarify again, even if this is politically motivated, the issue of disinformation is real. In journalism, you vet everything first, even if it's just simply asking questions. I mean, you don't make distinctions between commentary, reportage on one hand, and then interview questions on the other. Mm-hmm. I mean, just like you, Carmina, when you ask questions, you have to make sure that the questions you will ask will have to be vetted first. Mm-hmm. It's wrong for Celis to say that it's his right to ask questions whether he has accurate sources of information or not. That's very irresponsible of him.
Which brings me to my next point. You were kind of touching on this a while ago about it being politically motivated and really the power of Congress to grant franchises or not. And I want to focus now on NTC itself, right? NTC, by its mandate, can act motu proprio on any irregularity that they see, right? In fact, there has been a complaint filed by a private individual since last year, also pertaining to the red tagging that's allegedly happening at the network. That's up for resolution, and now you have this, the NTC acting on the resolution coming from the House of Representatives. What does that tell you, Professor?
First of all, why did they prioritize? Even assuming for the sake of argument that there was a case that was filed since, you know, a long time ago, last year, why is it that they would heed the call of Congress a few days after the resolution was filed? You know, Carmina, when NTC meted out that suspension order, it reminded, and maybe later on we can touch on the remarks of Senator Aimee Marcos, it behooves you to ask why is it that, number one, NTC is quick to listen to certain government agencies like the House of Representatives, and in the case of Bulatlat, Pinoy Weekly, and 25 other websites, the National Security Council, when, as you know, the websites, including ours, were blocked by the NTC without the benefit of due process. Mm. So that's why, I'm sorry if I'll be jumping to the Senator Marcos's remarks. It makes me wonder why Aimee Marcos right now is crying the lack of due process on the part of NTC. But my question to her is this: where was she when 27 websites were being blocked? Again, we were saying that we were not accorded due process, and we had to learn about the NTC memorandum from from other sources of information, not from the NTC itself. Mm. So where were you, Madam Senator?
Which brings us now to the bigger issue here. Again, the power of a Congress to grant franchises, the lack of isolation of NTC when it comes to the political pressure. So what's the way out here? And can you actually rely on Congress to help solve this dilemma?
Okay, let me address the last question first. The quick answer is no. We cannot rely on Congress, and that's why we have to rely on public pressure for it to do the exact opposite of its vested interests. Okay, what can be done? I said this time and again, we have to remove the power of Congress to grant, or to be more specific, the House of Representatives, to grant congressional legislative broadcast franchises.
But to do that, do you have to tinker with the Constitution?
Okay, I think, a lawyer would be in a better position to comment on that. But from what I know, Carmina, from my limited understanding of the law, we need to abolish the Republic Act that established the law pertaining to broadcast franchises where you need the approval. What was referenced there was the Philippine legislature, because in the 1930s, we were still under colonial rule. Mm. That's what I think, at least. But a lawyer may be in a better position to comment if it requires constitutional changes.
But even so, Professor, you're going to have to rely on Congress to sort of to amend, to relinquish. But can you actually expect them to do that, given that, you know, this benefits them as well, having that power over giving franchises? Yeah. Go ahead.
Yes, actually, that's an excellent point, Carmina. We cannot rely on them, and that's where public pressure comes in. And I'm sorry if this sounds a bit vague, but we have to still try, okay? Because even if we are unsuccessful, you know, campaigns like this are worth pursuing and worth pushing for. And if ever they are confronted, let's say, with a House bill or a House resolution pertaining to the stripping away of such power to grant broadcast franchises, if they reject it, then it exposes them even more of, you know, being too much interested in perpetuating themselves in power and spreading their power and influence even to the media. It's just like the anti-dynasty bill. It's been there since time immemorial, and it further exposes the different congresses for their refusal to approve a law that would hit at the very structure of Congress.
Mm. What do you think about people who tend to, you know, trivialize what is happening now and just whittle it down to, you know, what goes around comes around? Is it as simple as that? Or is there something more to this that we really should be concerned about?
Okay, first of all, Carmina, we cannot blame the people if they think that SMNI had it coming. And that, as you said, what goes around comes around, na karma rin sila, puti nga sa kanila. You know, such discourses are understandable given the notoriety of SMNI. And right now, the running joke in the journalism education community is, if you want to teach journalism, let them watch SMNI and then tell them that it's the exact opposite of journalism. That's it. They can get their degree. But levity aside, Carmina, we have to further defend the context, and that's why we have to be more nuanced in our analysis of what SMNI is going through. Mm. Because it's not just simply the discourse on what goes around comes around, and that never mind if the laws are repressive as long as it is useful sometimes to our interest. We have to be more long-term, and that's why, Carmina, even if we are a bit skeptical about Congress giving up its power to grant broadcast franchises, a House bill or a House resolution should be done. So if some of the members of Congress are listening right now, I hope we can get this going. And since I have some time next year, I'm more than willing to help out if deemed necessary.
All right. And talking about next year, you know, 2023, it gave our industry a lot, right? I'm not even talking about 2020, but 2023, you know, there were some bright sides to it. There was also this, as you correctly pointed out, it can have a chilling effect. It does have a chilling effect. But come 2024, where do you think new cycles will be? What will influence new cycles come next year?
Well, we need a separate segment on that, because in terms of technology, for example, artificial intelligence is a major issue, and that's why it's necessary for media to come up with concrete deadlines. Concrete guidelines that would ensure that deadlines are met, but at the same time, ethics would still be observed. But of course, on a more political side, Carmina, we have to ensure that the culture of impunity will end. Because we would see more of it in the near future. We might even have situations where the killings of journalists would continue, and that harassment and intimidation would still be the order of the day. Mm-hmm. Right now, Carmina, red tagging has become normalized, and that's why it's such a welcome relief, going back to the case of SMNI, that for many of us, we think that they deserve to be shut down, albeit you know, the chilling effect should be closely observed, and that right now those who cry press freedom, those who cry violations of freedom of expression, they are actually the ones perpetuating that when ABS-CBN, Rappler, Bulatlat, and other news media organizations had to go through, you know, a lot of things right now. So that's the problem, Carmina, with 2024. We have to remain vigilant, and we have to challenge the powers that be to make sure that the necessary reforms would be done. And I think, given these developments these past few weeks, two major policy reforms would have to be made, if not reviewed. Number one, the power of Congress to grant legislative franchises. And number two, the probable abolition of the MTRCB, given its tendency to censor, even if sometimes they do responsible gatekeeping, as in the case of SMNI. Mm-hmm. So we cannot have it both ways. We cannot just have faith in, quote-unquote, the powers that be that they would do the right thing. We have to institute the policy measures that would force whoever's in power that they have to do what is right because that is the law.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. Professor Danilo Aro there, he's an associate professor at the UP Journalism Department. Merry Christmas to you. Thanks for making yourself available and accessible the whole year round, and we hope to have more of these conversations next year. Thanks again, Prof. Dan.
Yes, happy holidays to you and to your loved ones, Carmina.
And to you too. Take care.